everyone, welcome to Tacobots YouTube channel. My name is Ohm, and today I'm going to be giving you guys a walkthrough of the FLL Spike Prime kit. So let's get started. First, I'm going to discuss motors and sensors. So a typical Spike Prime kit comes with a total of three motors. One large motor that has more torque, therefore more power, and two medium motors used for more minute and fine-grained tasks. Then there's also three sensors included with the kit. One is a distance sensor, also known as an ultrasonic sensor. The sensor uses sound waves and echolocation, essentially, to navigate its surroundings and determine the distance from certain objects. Second is the force sensor, or also sometimes called the touch sensor, which essentially has a value of 0 or 1 assigned to the sensor based on touch. So, for example, if the black knob in the front shown here is pressed, the value may be 1, and then if it's released, it would be 0. And then lastly, there's also a color sensor provided. A color sensor has two main functions. One, it can detect the different types of colors there are on a field, which is very useful in FLL, considering that the mat does have several different colors. And second, it also has an ability to measure the reflective intensity of light, which essentially allows users to calibrate their robots in different light-lit environments. For example, if your competition does have higher brightness than your garage at home, you can account for that with a program written using the reflective light intensity gauged by the color sensor. And also, every Spike Prime kit comes with a brick, or also called a large hub, and this is essentially the brain of the robot. This is what stores all the code and runs all the code, and you can see there's a little navigation button here and a display up here. This hub also has 6 ports in total, and these ports are used to connect to, of course, the parts I mentioned earlier. And they connect through these wires, JST pin connectors, straight in. And lastly, there's also a micro USB cable used to charge the large hub. The large hub also comes with a battery that is, of course, rechargeable. So what you do is you just click in the large battery, and then you can always charge it through the micro USB cable. Next, I'm going to be discussing the structural portions of the FLL Spike Prime kit. So here are the main structural parts. I didn't include all of them because some of them are a bit more arbitrary. But first, in the top left, we have new frames. So as you can see down here, there are picture frames, as I like to call them, which are essentially 5x7 frames. And these are the ones that have been included in the old LEGO Technic kit as well. However, in the Spike Prime kit, you are also given access to two more frames, one 11x15 frame and one 7x9 frame, I believe. These are two different sizes, which are very useful in building a robot and, again, providing structure to that robot. Then you also have the typical Technic beams, which comes in all different sizes, right? So you have a 13M beam, meaning 13 holes, and also a 7M beam, 7 holes, 5M beam, 11M beam, also 9M beams and 15M beams, as shown down here. So you essentially have an access to a lot of different parts. And then you also have angular beams, like 90-degree beams, as well as J beams, which are shown down here. And these parts are all useful in a variety of different scenarios. Typically, J-beams are used on the side of a robot to provide stability. L-beams are, of course, used to connect beams or parts that are at a 90-degree angle. And beams overall are just used to give structure to the entire robot, of course, in a linear fashion. And there's also a T-beam, which serves a similar purpose as an angle beam, but it's done in a more compact fashion. So if that's the requirements of your robot, you can always do that. And then there's also a biscuit. There's different kinds of, they're the same biscuit, but different colors. And essentially allows you to have a connection point here and then essentially change the axis of the connection point. Right? If you can imagine this would be the x-axis, this would become the y-axis. So you can essentially connect something on the x-axis and have access to the y-axis. Access to the y-axis. Down here, you also have a rack and pinion setup, which have some, the rack and pinion essentially a mechanism that uses a gear that rides along this rack, and this rack can be connected to anything, for example, a moving wall, right? So you can have a gear ride along this rack and have something attached to the gear, which in this case, I'm mentioning a wall, to essentially have a moving wall along this rack and pinion. It's one of the various common linear slide mechanisms. There's also a flat panel just used for general connectivity and overall aesthetic, and I mentioned those beams already. Now we'll be talking about connectors. So the Spike Prime kit has a variety of connectors, and there are some key differences I want to note with them. So first of all, the first in the top left is a connector peg with friction, 3M. So this is a blue peg, I like to refer to it. And it's essentially very useful because you have, for example, one beam attached on this side, and you can have up to two beams attached on this side. So essentially, it gives you an additional length in comparison to a normal connector peg, which is useful in, again, a variety of scenarios to connect multiple beams together, string them through. This can be very useful. And also, there's a typical connector peg, which you get 72 of, so you have a wealth of them. And they're just used, of course, to connect the entire robot, right? I mean, they act like, if you continue with that body analogy, they're like your joints. So they connect all parts of your robot and keep them stable. There's also a cross axle and a peg, or I like to call it an axe peg, one of the varieties of the axe pegs. So essentially, this blue peg has been converted into an axe peg of the same fashion, where you could have, for example, an attachment to your robot here, and then have maybe a dead wheel attached to this. And then next, you also have a connector peg or a cross axle, which is, again, the same as this peg, but just has an axle on this side. So I like to call it an axe peg. And it's just used to connect things that have axles or cross axle shaped holes, like maybe these connectors, for example, to something that's more beam like with holes, with those circular holes that we're familiar with. And then there's the ball snap, which essentially is just giving you like an extra peg to stick out if you are ever in case you need one. And one key thing with all these pegs is they have friction. So earlier in the Technic kit, there used to be pegs with friction and pegs without friction. And while there does seem to be a minute difference, it can help you in several different instances. For example, when you need more structure, of course, you need more friction to keep those pieces together. And that's where you want to generally use these friction pieces. And they used to have non-friction pieces, which are used for things that you'd like to rotate along the axle. Or sorry, not the axle, along the peg. So just the key difference I'd like to note there. Then this kind of ties it up to these over here on the top right. I've listed some angle elements. So there's, and these are generally used with cross axles or the axle system. So there's an axle, by the way, is something you should be familiar with. Essentially is this, and it's used for generally rotation and motion throughout the robot. So here we have a cross axle connection, which essentially means that you can connect two axles together using this connector here. All these actually do the same thing. They connect two axles, but just in different ways. So these two connect two axles at 180 degrees. And these three actually have these peg holes here if you want to attach them to a part of your robot to make it more stable. And this is a 180 degrees. This is a 90 degree or a right angle connector. And this is a 135 degree, a little more specific, but it can be useful in certain cases. So these are the connectors in general. They're just very useful in connecting axles. And now onto the main parts down here, the main connectors, I would say. So these are like, so these are the 2mm friction snaps. So essentially, the reason they're called snap is because they don't have anything on the other side for you to use, essentially. So you just snap it right in. And generally, it's used to secure parts or kind of hold them in for the long term. Generally used on the drivetrain of the robot or like the base that drives the robot. That's where you would see these pieces used most often. Here you have a beam 1M with two snaps. So again, it's like a little longer version of this. And essentially, you can just add an extra layer of support with this hole in the middle and just connect two pieces together. And this is one of my favorite connectors, the H connector. So this is very useful. Or these two are actually both my favorite connectors. The H connector is very useful in a variety of different scenarios. You can connect two frames together. You can connect virtually any structural part together. And you also have these extra holes on the side. In fact, holes going on almost all axes, which is very useful in a variety of build scenarios. And here you have a 90 degree angle connector. This is also similar to the L, goes along in a variety of axes, right? You can see there's an X axis and a Y axis connection point, which is very useful again in a variety of build scenarios because again, your build is 3D, right? So you need to have as many connection points as possible. And the L piece generally tends to bail you out in a lot of different scenarios where you need connections. And lastly, you have an I-frame. This is a relatively new part, but again, it has those two axes that I mentioned earlier. Essentially, the more axes something has as a connector, the more effective it is, in my opinion. So here you see you have the x-axis and the y-axis going up and x-axis going through. So you can connect things in different ways. All right. Now I want to talk about motion, the motion parts included in the kit. So there are not that many of them, I would say, but these are all very essential to your build. So first of all, you do have wheels. And wheels are, of course, used to drive your robot. And, you know, that's just about that. They're used to drive your robot around and on the mat. Then you also have a wedge belt, so these are used for your belt drives. Ordinarily, in FLL, they do use rubber rather than belt. But these are used for your wedge belts and your wedge belt wheel. So you can have a rubber sitting on this part. Or if you want to use this as, like, maybe a dead wheel or something a little more fine-tuned of a wheel, you can just add the tire for it. You also have the tire low narrow, which is just for the smaller wheels. Or also you can put it on top of these gears. And you have three different kinds of gears. So the Z in front of the gears, essentially the tooth count. So it's a 36 tooth gear, 28 tooth gear, 12 tooth gear. They're called a double conical wheel, but essentially it's just a gear. And these gears are very useful because, as you may or may not know, gears are great ways to change the speed and torque of a certain mechanism. For example, if you have, let's say, a 100 RPM motor, RPM meaning revolutions per minute, so the motor runs at a certain speed, you can put a 12-tooth gear on it, and connect that to a 36-tooth gear, creating a 1-to-3 gear ratio. And that would essentially increase the torque by threefold, but also decrease the speed to about 30 RPM. And then there's also the 28-tooth gear, like I mentioned. So these are varieties of gears you can use to change the speed and torque. We'll have a video coming out on the speed and torque later, but this is a short overview of what they're used for. Then this is a really important thing. So in FLL, you generally don't use a robot with four wheels because you have a limited number of motors. So instead of having four motors for four different wheels, you have two motors. And in the back, you balance it using this thing called a caster ball. So a caster ball comes with a caster ball cup. And as you can see, there's an eye connector here built into the caster ball cup. So that just, again, shows the usefulness of it, connecting things in different axes or different planes, I guess, rather. So you have a caster ball here. It's placed on the bottom. And then essentially it has full rotation in all directions. So you can have two wheels driving and have this balance in the back. I think we'll have a picture coming out soon on what a typical robot looks like. And here are the miscellaneous parts. So there's some these parts are like miscellaneous because they're generally used for aesthetic. So you have the bow panel, left shell, right shell. So again, just used to maybe design your robot, make it look cool. Or in some cases, you may find a use for this attachment, but generally we in the past have never seen many uses of this. And then there's a wire clip. So they're used to control, clip your wires and do some wire management on your robot to, again, make it look more aesthetic. You also have bricks. The bricks, they're relatively new parts. They haven't been introduced in the Lego Technic set. They're a different kind of part. But if you ever need to, I guess, add structure or build something, right, rather than stack beams on top of each other, I suppose you could use this brick. And lastly, you have a panel. Looks very much like a circuit board. And you should have a variety of connection points. And you could very well use this to build, for example, a wall. Right, like I mentioned earlier, you can maybe have a rack and pinion attached to the side of this and build a moving wall where you can have all your attachments based on this one wall. So again, this just provides a lot of versatility to the build and overall is very useful. So I guess there's that. And that's it for the video, guys. Thanks for listening. Hope you guys enjoyed it and got an idea of what a Spark Prime kit looks like. Hope to see you guys next time. Thank you.